I might use the verse, I have arrived. I'm home. I have arrived. I'm home. Or you might like to say, I listen deeply. This wonderful sound brings me back to my true home. Or you might say, breathing in, I feel calm, I relax. Breathing out, I smile. Calming, smiling. Breathing in, I establish myself in the present moment. Breathing out, I know this is a wonderful moment. Calming, smiling. Present moment, wonderful moment. When you come home to the present moment, with your in-breath, you become fully alive, fully present. You can touch life in the here and the now. You feel that you are alive. You touch the miracle that you are alive. Because to be alive, that is the greatest of all miracles. And with only one in-breath, you can touch that miracle. That is why you can say, present moment, wonderful moment. If someone asks you, my dear friend, has the most wonderful moment of your life arrived? He wants to know whether the most wonderful moment of your life has arrived. It would be a pity if such a moment does not arrive at all. Then you may have the tendency to say, oh, it does not seem that it has arrived, that wonderful moment. But I'm sure that it will arrive soon, sometime in the future. And that is our tendency to answer. But if we keep living like the way we have lived our life in the past 20 years, it will not arrive in the next 20 years. It might not arrive at all, that moment we call the most wonderful moment of our life. And for many, many of us, that moment does not arrive at all. Until we die. The Buddha said, you have to make the present moment into the most wonderful moment of your life. And this is possible. Because if you are able to go home to the present moment, to the here and the now, become fully alive, become fully present, you can touch all the wonders of life within yourself and around you. Everything belonging to you is a wonder. Your eye, your ear, your nose, your body, your mind. And because you are not mindful, you don't touch them deeply, you don't know that they are wonders until you die. And you begin to regret that you have not lived at all. That is why our true home must be sought in the here and the now. It can be touched in the here and the now. My true home is not limited to a place. To a time. My true home is not Vietnam. My true home is not France. My true home is not America. My true home is not Africa. My true home is not the Palestine. My true home is not Israel. Although they don't let me go back to Vietnam, I still have my true home available in the here and now. And maybe they are in Vietnam, but they don't have a home. That is why I don't feel as a victim. And I don't feel that they are my enemies. They are victims of fear. They believe that if I go home, I will create an atmosphere of solidarity, of friendship, of brotherhood that may be threatening to their power. And it is fear. That is an obstacle. And I want to help them to be free from fear. They are not my enemies. They are the ones I want to help. They are object of my practice of compassion and understanding. I have no enemies. During the war, during the Vietnam War, it was so difficult for us to voice our concern. Most of us did not want the war. The war put us in a situation where brothers have to kill brothers and kill with foreign weapons and ideologies. Communism and anti-communism are imported, were imported. Also, weapons used by the communists were imported. Weapons used by anti-communists were imported. So they gave us guns and ideologies and urged us to fight each other and kill each other. We started a movement called Don't Shoot Your Brother. And our voice was silenced by both sides of both warring parties. We tried to speak out. We tried to tell you in the world that we don't want the war. We don't want the killing of each other with foreign weapons and foreign ideologies. And yet we were forced to do so. So those of us who practice mindfulness, understanding and compassion, we did not want to accept the war. We wanted to reconcile. And our voice was not allowed to be heard. Sometimes we have to burn ourselves alive in order to get the message across. Thích Quảng Đức, a friend of mine, one day he burned himself and his picture appear in a international press. I was in New York, and I saw that picture in the New York Times front page. It's a friend of mine. Nhất Chi Mai, one of the first six members of the Order of Interbeing, my disciple, she burned herself calling for reconciliation. She went to the Tư Nghiêm Temple in very early in the morning, about 2-3 o'clock in the morning. She put a statue of the Virgin Mary and Kuan Yin. She left behind a set of letters calling for the president of North Vietnam, the president of South Vietnam, for everyone to come together and stop the act of killing each other. And then she doused herself with gasoline and she burned herself. Nhất Chi Mai is a very close sister, close friend of Sư Cô Chân Không, Sister Chân Không, True Emptiness. I was in Paris. She left behind a letter for me. Thầy, don't worry. Peace will come. Don't suffer too much. Don't worry. She was about to die. And then, but she tried to comfort me, her teacher. It's very, very difficult for us to voice our concern. Although we are the majority in the country, we did not want to the war. My book of poetry, peace poetry, I like to call it peace poetry than rather than anti-war poetry. It was condemned by the North and confiscated by the South. So when Cornell University invited me to come and make a series and give a series of lectures, I took the opportunity to go out and to call for peace. And in June the 1st, in the year 1966, I met Martin Luther King in Chicago. Exactly 1 year before, on June 1st, 1965, I wrote him a letter, explaining to him why we had burned ourselves. This is not an act of suicide. This is an act of love. You want to transmit a message, but you have no other ways. You have to burn yourself in order for your message to get across. So the suffering of the monk who burned herself to get the message across, message of love and compassion. It's of the same nature of the act of Jesus Christ dying on the cross, dying with no hate, no anger, only with compassion, leaving behind a compassionate call for peace, for brotherhood. So exactly 1 year after I met him in Chicago, we talked for some time, and then after that, we went out to meet with the press. And that day he came out against the war in Vietnam. And that day, that is the day when we combine our efforts of working for peace in Vietnam and fighting for civil rights in America. Two years later, I met him again in Geneva. In a conference called Pax Sementiris, organized by the World Council of Churches. There are people like Linus Pauling at the conference. He stayed in the 11th floor. I was on the 4th floor. He invited me up for breakfast. I was retained by the press. I came up late. And he kept the breakfast warm for me and waited for me. I told him, Martin, you know something? In Vietnam, they call you a bodhisattva. They call you a bodhisattva, an enlightened being, trying to awaken other living beings and help them go in the direction of compassion and understanding. I'm glad I had the chance to tell him, because a few months later he was assassinated in Memphis. We were in France. We had a bureau, an office representing the Buddhist community in Vietnam. And we wanted to represent the mass of people who did not have a voice. They did not have a chance to speak out. So we live as a community in Paris, and our office in a poor quarter of Paris, number 11, La Goutte d'Or Street, and that quarters were inhabited more by the people of Arab origin. Every time I applied for a visa to go to America, it was turned down automatically. They didn't want me to come to America because they believe that I harm, I may be harmful, I may be an obstacle for the war efforts in Vietnam. I was not allowed to go to America. I was not allowed to go to England. Every time I wanted to go to America to on a speaking tour, I had to write a letter to someone like Senator McGovern or Senator Robert Kennedy, asking them to send me a letter of invitation. The letter is something like this: Dear Thich Nhat Hanh, I would like to know more about the situation of the war in Vietnam. Please come and inform me. And if you have difficulties concerning the visa, please telephone me at this number. Only with such a letter that I could have a visa. Otherwise, there's no way. I remember one day I flew from Japan back to Paris. I did not have a visa. For transit in Seattle. I flew from Tokyo to New York via Seattle and then to Paris. I want to stop in New York in order to meet with a friend in the peace movement, Alfred Hassler of the Fellowship of Reconciliation. And when I landed in Seattle, well, I was locked in a place where I could not see anyone. I look around and see many pictures and wanted. They took my passport. They didn't allow me to be in touch with anyone. And then when the plane is about to take off, they gave my passport back. It's very difficult. One day when I was in Washington, D.C., I told you already, the Baltimore Sun, a reporter came and informed me that there's a dispatch from Saigon informing the government of the United States of America, of France, of England, United Kingdom, and of Japan, asking them not to honor the passport of Thich Nhat Hanh, because he has been saying things that are not helpful to the war efforts against communism. And in Vietnam, my books, my articles, my poetry was banned by both the communist and the anti-communist. I risk deportation and put in jail because of what I have done. I had done a calling for peace and speaking against the war. It was my intention to go only for 3 months to give a series of lecture in Cornell and then to make a tour of America and Europe and go home. I was working with my friends in a school of youth for social service, the Van Hanh Buddhist University that I founded and helped found it in 64. All my friends, co-workers who were in Vietnam, I didn't want to go very long. I intended to come here only for 3 months. But it has been 38 years already. I have not been able to go home, 38 years. And that is why I have been sharing the practice with friends in Europe, in America, in other countries. But because I have found my true home, I don't suffer. The truth is that during the first year of my being in exile, it was difficult, quite difficult. Although I was already 40, although I was already a Dharma teacher, having many monks and nuns as students, disciples, and yet I had not found my true home. I can give very good lectures on Buddhism, on the practice of Buddhism. But I had not truly arrived. Intellectually, well, I had a lot of Buddhism. I had been trained several years in a Buddhist institute, and practicing since the time I was 16. And during the time I was a young monk, I tried my best to renew Buddhism, update Buddhism, so that Buddhism can respond to the real situation of suffering, called engaged Buddhism. The kind of Buddhism that can offer you the answers to the burning question of society. Questions like war, social injustice, political suppression, poverty, violence, and so on. It was very difficult for me during the first 2 years, because my intention was to bring about information to the world, the kind of information that were not available to people, because the warring parties, they had all the mass media. And in speaking tour, I slept 1 or 2 nights in each city. In America, in Europe, in Australia, and so on. There were times when I woke up in the night, I did not know where I was. Very difficult, very hard. And after, well, I had to breathe in and out and to find out where I was, what city, what country. And I dreamt of going home to my root temple in central Vietnam, climbing a hill, a green hill, beautiful trees. And half the way to the top of the hill, I woke up and realized that I was in exile. And the same kind of dream repeated again and again. I was very active. I was making friends with many people, Catholic priests, Protestant ministers, professors, young people, children, And my practice was a practice of mindfulness. I try to live in the here and now and touch the wonders of life in my daily life. I survive with that practice. The trees in Europe were so different from the trees in Vietnam. The fruits, the flowers, they are all different. And the people also. So I learned to make friends and play with German children, French children, American children, British children. I make friends with Anglican priest, Catholic priest, Protestant ministers, and so on. But thanks to that practice, I was able to find my true home in the here and the now. And I stopped suffering, and the dream did not come back anymore. People think that I suffer when I cannot go back to Vietnam, but that's not the case. If I go to Vietnam, that would be a joy to be able to offer the teaching to the monks, the nuns, the lay people there, and talk to the artists, to the writers and others. But if I cannot go, I don't have to suffer. I can meet with other people in other countries, like in China, in Korea, in Japan, in Spain, in England, in Canada, and so on. And the formula, I have arrived. I am home. Is the embodiment, the expression of my practice. It expresses my understanding of the teaching of the Buddha. It is the cream of my practice. I have arrived, I am home. And since the time I have found my true home, I don't suffer. I did not suffer anymore. The past is no longer a prison for me. The future is no longer a prison for me. I'm able to live in the here and the now. I'm able to touch my true home. And I know that the future is available through the present. This is what I have found. When you touch the present moment deeply, you touch the past. And if you know how to handle the present moment properly, you heal the past. Many think that the past is already gone, you cannot do anything. You cannot go back to the past and fix things and repair things. But according to this teaching of the Buddha, the past is still there with all the pain and suffering. And if you know how to come home to the present moment and touch the present moment deeply, you touch the past and you can heal the past. And when you heal yourself, you heal your ancestors. And this is possible. My ancestors have suffered in me. I have also suffered. And since I am able to touch the present moment deeply, I heal myself and I heal my ancestors, including my parents, my father, my mother, my brother, my sister, my grandfather, my grandmother. When I practice walking, I generate the energy of freedom and solidity. And I feel that all my ancestors enjoy the freedom and the solidity that I generate with the practice of walking. Because to me, my ancestors are always alive in me, fully present in me, in every cell of my body. And if I am free, they are free. If I am healed, they are healed. When I take a step with solidity and freedom, all of them take that step with me. And you have to take that step with all your being. Full awareness, full concentration, in order to, for that step to be really solid, to be free, in order for you to be able to touch life, the wonders of life in that moment, that is healing and nourishing. So the act of making a step is an act of freedom, an act of liberation. You liberate yourself, you liberate your ancestors. It's an act of revolution. Please believe me. You cannot make such a step unless you invest entirely your body and your mind. 100%. When you breathe in, you bring all yourself together, body and mind. You become one. And equipped with that energy of mindfulness and concentration, you make a step. And you have the insight that this is your true home. This is you are alive, you are fully present, you are touching life as a reality. Your true home is not an abstract idea. It is a solid reality that you can touch with your feet, with your hand, and with your mind. The kingdom of God, or the Pure Land of the Buddha, for me, they are not abstract ideas. That is something you can touch in every moment, you can live in every moment. It is available in the here and the now. If you know how to make yourself available, and then the kingdom is available, the Pure Land is available, your true home is available. And nobody can take away your true home. They can occupy your country, yes. They can put you in prison, yes. But they cannot take away your true home and your freedom.